So we'll read this passage. This passage is one of the CAT passages that came in way back in CAT 2004. And this passage is a classic example of a passage which is long, and let's say sometimes it may have lots of things, but the questions are easy. So you cannot simply say that because the passage is long, it's going to be a difficult passage, or because the passage is short, it's going to be an easy passage. The length of the passage is not always the right indicator of the difficulty level. So that is the first thing that we have to understand. Sometimes even short passages can have a density of information. So for example, sometimes the author has taken too many words to express the same idea time and again. And sometimes he has just written a small paragraph, but the density of information is very high. So the density of information is more important rather than the length of the passage. So these two are two different things. The length basically means the number of words, that's it. But there could be, just one single idea which the author has discussed again and again, providing lots of supporting ideas for that single idea. Whereas the density of information is different ideas, lots of new ideas. Every sentence has it something new, and that's why it becomes difficult for the reader to cope with such passages. So sometimes when you read the first few lines of a passage, you get a feeling that this is going to be a pretty much manageable passage. On the other hand, sometimes when you read the three, four lines of the passage, you get a feeling that this is not going to be an easy nut to crack, because you feel that there are lots of strong things coming in. So this is a passage which has fewer ideas in too many words, right? So recently I spent several hours sitting under a tree in my garden with the social anthropologist William Ury, a Harvard University professor who specializes in the art of negotiation. So the author has spent time with someone. He captivated me with his theory that tribalism protects people. So this is more important, that the author was captivated by the theory that tribalism protects people from fear of rapid change. So rather than spending the idea under a banyan tree or a mango tree, that is not important. But yes, what they discussed and what was the main issue of the discussion, that is more important. He explained that the pillars of tribalism that humans rely on for security would always counter any significant cultural or social change. Again, the same thing. In this way, he said, change is never allowed to happen too fast. Again, the same thing. Technology, for example, is a pillar of society. Yuri believes that every time technology moves in a new or radical direction, another pillar such as religion or nationalism will grow stronger. The traditional and familiar will assume greater importance to compensate for the new and untested. In this manner, human tribes avoid rapid change that leaves people insecure and frightened. So when you read the first paragraph, you get to know that the author simply talks about spending time with a professor, and the professor says that tribalism protects people from rapid change. They fear, and the example is technology. He says that whenever technology moves in a new radical direction, something will definitely come up to oppose that. But we all have heard that nothing is as permanent as change. Nothing is guaranteed. The author says pithy expressions to be sure, but no more than cliche. So cliche basically means something which is commonly used but does not have significance. As Yuri says, people don't live that way from day to day. So again, you see that the opinion of Yuri has come and the general opinion has come. So people believe that change is permanent. Nothing is guaranteed, but Yuri says people don't live that way. On the contrary, they actively seek certainty and stability. They want to know they will be safe. Even so, we scare ourselves constantly with the idea of change. An IBM CEO once said, "We only restructure for a good reason, and if we haven't restructured in a while, that's a good reason." We are scared that competitors, technology, and consumer will put us out of business, so we have to change all the time. But if we asked our fathers and grandfathers, would they have said that they lived in a period of little change? Structure may not have changed much. It may just the speed with which we do things. So the author again says that, structure hasn't changed, the speed of doing things has changed, change is not happening. Change is overrated anyway. Consider the automobile. It's an especially valuable example because the auto industry has spent tens of billions of dollars on research and product development in the last 100 years. Henry Ford's first car had a metal chassis with an internal combustion gasoline-powered engine, four wheels with rubber tires, a foot-operated clutch assembly and brake system, a steering wheel. So lots of detail, you know. But what exactly the author wants to drive at? He says 100 years later and 10,000 hours of research later, we drive cars with a metal chassis in London at 7.5 miles per hour. So he's putting all this information just to tell us that change is overrated. You take the example of automobile. 100 years ago, it had the same thing. We could drive at 18 miles per hour, and 100 years down the line, you still have the same thing, and you are driving at 17.5 miles per hour. So the purpose of the paragraph is more important rather than the details. The purpose is that change is overrated. 100 years ago, we were at the same stage. Even today, we are at the same stage. So the author says that's not a hell of a lot of return for the money. Ford evidently doesn't have much to teach us about change. The fact that they are still manufacturing cars is not proof that Ford Motor is a sound organization. Just proof that it takes very large companies to make cars in great quantities, making for almost impregnable entry barrier. 50 years after the development of the jet engine, planes are also little changed. They have grown bigger, wider, and carry more people. But those are incremental, largely cosmetic changes. This is what the author says. Taken together, this lack of real change has come to mean that in travel, whether driving or flying, time and technology have not combined to make things much better. So you can sense that criticism. The criticism that change has not happened. And the author is simply giving different examples. He comes up with automobile and then he says that at the same time, moving around in cars or aeroplanes becomes less and less efficient. Not only has there been no great change, but also both forms of transport have deteriorated as more people clamor to use them. The same is true for telephones, which took over hundreds of years to become mobile, or photographic film, which also required an entire century to change. The only explanation for this is anthropological. Once established in calcified organizations, humans do two things. They sabotage changes that might render people dispensable and ensure industry-wide emulation. In the 1960s, German auto companies developed plans to scrap the entire combustion engine for electrical design. The same existed in the 1970s in Japan and in the 1980s in France. So for 40 years, we might have been free of the wasteful and ludicrous dependence on fossil fuels. Why didn't it go anywhere? Because auto executives understood pistons and carburetors and would be unwilling to cannibalize their expertise along with most of the factories. So again, you have the example of auto industry where people knew that there was an electrical design possible, but the change did not go ahead because they resisted change. So if you look at the whole passage, there are too many words, but these words have not given you too many ideas. In fact, the words are focusing on the same thing again and again. And that same thing is that change is not welcome, people resist change, change is not happening. So, you know, I would say that overall, easy to read passage. And if you really want to map the passage, initially the author introduces the idea of tribalism. Then later on he goes and gives the example of IBM CEO. Then he gives the example of automobile where he says that 100 years down the line, the speed is still the same. And then he gives example of other things, and then towards the end again automobile. So though the word automobile is dominating the passage, that is not the central idea of the passage. Automobile is just an example, a supporting example of the main idea that change is indeed not happening. People resist change. So you have to go and take the first question. It says, which of the following best describes one of the main ideas discussed in the passage? So A says rapid change is welcome. This is exactly opposite of what the author wants to say. The author wants to say that change is not welcomed, and you say that change is welcomed. And then C says we should have less change than we have now. The problem is, you know, that when you say we should have less change, that basically means there is too much of change. When you say that we should have less change, you are implying that there is too much of change, but change is not there at all. So the idea of having less of it doesn't make any sense. C goes out. And then you have two choices, B and D. Industry is not as innovative. Precisely, this is the right answer. Why? Because automobile, they are not as innovative. Telephone, not as innovative. Aeroplanes, the services. So author has given the example. So industry is not as innovative. Why? Because they are not changing. They resist change. Now the point is, you might say, sir, what about D? Competition spurs companies into. But is it happening? People might, we believe that competition spurs companies into radical innovation, but that is not happening. Because if this is happening, then the change is happening. But the author says change is not happening. The author is lamenting that change is not happening. So either D is correct. That means, yes, competition is triggering radical innovation, or the author's central idea is correct. So D is again the central idea. You have B as the right answer. I would say this is an easy question. Guru, second question now. So it says here, according to the passage, which of the following statements is true? So you have to just go and check every option and see whether it is true or not. Executives of automobile companies are inefficient, ludicrous. So sometimes you might get a feeling that executives of... So where has this executives thing come here? If you scroll down to the very bottom of the page, it says here, because auto executives understood. So it says here, for 40 years, we might have been free of the wasteful and ludicrous dependence on... So the auto executives are not ludicrous. Our dependence on fossil fuels is ludicrous as per the author, and we might have been free of it had we chosen the electrical design. And why didn't it go anywhere? Because auto executives understood pistons and carburetors, and they were unwilling to cannibalize. So the auto executives' expertise was with pistons and carburetors, and they did not want to cannibalize it. So it is not that they were inefficient. They were, they might have been very much efficient with their work, but they were selfish, and they deliberately did not want electrical engines to come. Why? Because that means that they would have to compromise with their own expertise. So suppose if I'm a verbal faculty and I teach VARC, I would not tell CAT to remove VARC from the exam, because that means I'm cannibalizing my own expertise. So auto executives are not inefficient. The auto executives are unwilling, or they are selfish, or they do not want change to happen. That doesn't mean they were inefficient and they were ridiculous. I mean, A is not the right choice. B says the speed at which an automobile is driven in a city has not changed much. And you have the example. It says 18 miles, right? So if you look at the passage, then 18 miles per hour was the speed, and even today you have 75 miles per hour in London. So the speed at which automobile is driven has not changed much in a century. Looks a good choice, and therefore B is indeed the right option. Correct. So I would mark B, and B is correct. Depend. Anthropological factors have not fostered innovation. They have actually blocked innovation. Fostering is not the right word. Blocking is the right word. So again, C goes. Further innovation in jet engines has been more than. Now the problem is, when you say some incremental means basically small amount. When you say something is incremental, then something is in a small amount. And when it is more than incremental, that means it's a large amount. So if you say that something is more than incremental, something is more than large amount. So further innovation in jet engines has been significant. This is what you mean to say. But the author says it is insignificant. D goes out. So the option is B, which is, I think, the right answer. I mean, there is no doubt about it. Which of the following views does the author fully support in the past? So you have to look at the four choices, and you have to pick the one which the author fully supports. Now, change is not happening. So the author would not say that change is rapid. Similarly, more money spent on innovation leads to more rapid change. But the problem is that the change is not happening, and lots of money has been spent, but it's a waste. He has clearly given the example of Ford Motor. He says that that's a hell lot of bit money, and there is no return. And then you say over decades, structural change has been incremental. That means basic. Incremental means small amount. So when you say that structural change has been incremental, that means that change has been in small amount. So it's quite possible, right? The author has said that structure may have not have changed much. So the author says structure may not have changed much. And we can see it here. Structure may not have changed much. That means the structural change has been small in amount. It has been incremented. So we have evidence for D. And then many people think that option A is the right choice. Nothing is as permanent as change is what the author called as overrated. You have to mark for the view of the author which the author would support. But when you say nothing is as permanent as change, you mean to say that change is permanent. Change is the most permanent thing. Suppose if you say that no one is as handsome as my brother, that means your brother is the most handsome. Similarly, when you say nothing is as permanent as change, that means change is the only permanent thing, or change is the most permanent thing. But change is not happening. So where is the question of permanency? So A goes out. It is opposite of what the author wants to say. D is the right choice. So let's take fourth one now. According to the passage, the reason why we continue to depend on fossil fuels, why did we continue to depend on fossil fuel. We know that this thing has come towards the end of the passage. And we have to read the last part. The author says that because auto executives understood pistons and carburetors, this is what it says, they and would be loath. Loath means unwilling. So if you are unwilling to cannibalize, that means you did not want it to, you do not want the change to happen. That's why you are unwilling. And that's why option A is the right choice. They did not wish to change. Unwillingness is equal to loath. See, there is a difference between loath and there are two words. One is L-O-A-T-H and the other is L-O-A-T-H-E. So this loath is unwilling. This loath is unwilling and this loath is hatred. And the first one is used as an adjective. The second one is used as a verb. So I loathe you. That means you would use the loath, the second loath. This is the loath which is used as a verb. So the auto executives would be loath means would be unwilling. And therefore A is the right choice. Easy passage. See, understand, we always make impressions very quickly. That's the reason why most of us are not able to strategize VERs. Because we always go with certain trends. My suggestion is never go with preconceived notions. Always take things the way they come. That's the best way to prepare for VERs.